All right, well, good morning, everyone. I'm Rob Atkinson, President of ITIF, and we want to welcome you to this event this morning on the role of grand challenges in addressing major issues in our society going forward. And the reason we decided to put this on, partly from talking to Tom Kalil in the White House, and you'll hear more from Tom in just a minute about the new White House initiative going to be launched soon on framing grand challenges and teeing them up and how we move forward with them. So we really have a wonderful panel this morning. I'm going to introduce everybody. I'll make a few remarks and we'll turn it right over to them. Most of you should know Tom. Tom Kalil is the Deputy Director for Policy in the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, and he's also a Senior Advisor for Science and Technology at the National Economic Council. Prior to this stint in government, Tom was a Special Assistant to the Chancellor for Science and Technology at UC Berkeley. In the Clinton administration, he was the Deputy Assistant to President Clinton for Technology and Economic Policy, and also Deputy Director of the NEC. So he has a long, long background in science and technology policy, including obviously in government. Bill Fontaine is the Vice President, Technical Strategy and Worldwide Operations of Research for IBM. In that role, he is responsible for setting the direction of IBM's overall research strategy across 11 worldwide labs and leading the global operations and information systems teams. He has been with IBM for 21 years. I think that's longer than certainly longer than I've ever been at a job by a factor of three, I think. I'm celebrating my longest job at 7 years here. Previously, he served as General Manager of Global Technology Systems Services in the Middle East and Africa. He was also Vice President, Licensing and Business Development for IBM's intellectual property business, and part of what his work and his team, they've played a critical role in the creation of technology-based strategic alliances with partners around the world. And Dr. Fontaine has a PhD and a master's degree in material science and engineering from Cornell University. And Rick Valencia is the Vice President and General Manager of Qualcomm Life, which is a group, a part of Qualcomm Communications, which we all know is the leading wireless company. For the past 25 years, Rick has founded, built, and run technology-enabled business services. He is considered a pioneer in telecom services, and his past company, Profitline, helped launch what eventually became a multi-billion-dollar communications lifecycle management industry. In addition to managing Qualcomm Life, Rick oversees all other health and fitness devices and applications within Qualcomm. The reason both for Rick and Bill here is that they're both involved in, if you will, the grand challenges within their own companies, which we'll hear about in just a second. So to frame this, I think it's important to recognize that challenges, innovation grand challenges, are actually a pretty systemic part of the American science and technology legacy. I think probably will go down in history, I would guess for 1,000 years, this will go down in American history as the most successful grand challenge we've ever had and met. And that was the grand challenge that President Roosevelt set to build an atomic bomb before the Nazis. And within a period of, I believe, 4 years, we were able to do that successfully, and that certainly helped end World War II much more easily than it might have otherwise. But there have been other grand challenges. Obviously, Kennedy's grand challenge to, in the early 60s, to land a man on the moon and bring him back safely, that was a grand challenge. And in both of those cases, the efforts to do a grand challenge and to meet the grand challenge yielded enormous returns to society, enormous array of technologies that just weren't related directly to the technology we were trying to solve. Grand challenges aren't always successful. That's why they call them challenges. A case in point was President Nixon launched a grand challenge, which you may remember. One of the key ones that he had was the grand challenge was to end cancer through the war on cancer, and he devoted a significant amount of funds to do that. And obviously that hasn't worked, but again, that challenge and doing it certainly led to significant discoveries and advances. President Reagan had a grand challenge of Star Wars, a strategic defense initiative to be able to shoot down missiles. And again, that wasn't quite successful, although it led to important advances in military technology and other spin-offs. But one of the problems I think we have is that we have this view that grand challenges are something sort of on the side, a little bit strange, and that really what science progresses from is this sort of individual discovery mode. And that was really put in place, as many of you know, by Vannevar Bush, who was the president's science advisor in World War II, the president of MIT, and he wrote a definitive groundbreaking report right after World War II called Science, the Endless Frontier. And to me, the sort of fundamental quote in that report is this. Bush says, quote, "Scientific progress on a broad front results from the free play of free intellects working on subjects of their own choice in a manner dictated by their curiosity for exploration of the unknown. Freedom of inquiry must be preserved under any plan for government support of science in accordance with the five fundamentals." Well, so if you're a scientist, that's a great sort of business model. You just give me money and I get to do whatever the heck I want. And I have no real performance metrics other than I pursued my curiosity. And a lot of what we've done is in that vein, if you will, in that mode. And it's almost as if we have this view that if we try to actually go from point A to point B, that's really a big mistake. If you look at our current research and development tax credit, there's a provision in it that allows companies to take a slightly better credit if they give money to universities for research, which is a really good idea. The only problem with that is there's a provision in the law that says if that research is directed for anything possibly useful, you can't take the credit. It's got to be sort of just who knows what. So I think the whole point here is to say that we can actually have a system that preserves PI freedom, if you will, but also moves towards systemic goals, and that's what Tom's going to talk about now. So, Tom?
Okay. Well, it's a pleasure for me to be here this morning, and I want to thank Rob and ITIF for hosting this. And I also wanted to introduce one of my OSTP colleagues, Kristen Dorgelow, who's sitting in the front, who is the Assistant Director for Grand Challenges, which is by far the coolest title at OSTP. So if you want to get involved in this, you have to get to know Kristen. So I'm going to start by telling you what the punchline for this talk is, which is that we've got two companies here, IBM and Qualcomm, who have each in their own way embraced a grand challenge that they're going to be talking about. With IBM, it's been advancing the state-of-the-art of AI by beating the human Jeopardy champion and the chess champion before that. And with Qualcomm, it's a large incentive prize for a tricorder. And we have other institutions that are doing this as well. I'll talk about some of the government efforts. The National Academy of Engineering is involved in this. Foundations are involved in this. There are certainly venture capitalists that are backing startups that have incredibly broad goals. But what I'd like you to imagine is a scenario which over the next 3 to 5 years, the number of institutions that are involved in setting and pursuing a grand challenge dramatically increases. So as opposed to a handful of companies are doing this, some significant fraction of some of our most innovative companies are involved in this, that research universities are involved in this, that most government agencies have identified and are pursuing a grand challenge. And OSTP wants to contribute to that by elevating this issue and by organizing a White House conference later this summer in which we would highlight and celebrate those individuals and organizations that are publicly committed to pursuing a grand challenge. So that is what we're interested in doing. So grand challenges are easy, AB is hard. Can I get the next slide?
Alexis, can you do the slide?
Okay. So as Rob mentioned, the I think a canonical example of a grand challenge is President Kennedy's call to put a man on the moon and have him safely return by the end of the decade. Another example I would point to is the Human Genome Project. This was an investment of $3 billion, so you know the sequencing, the first one, was really expensive. The interesting thing is that in the last several years, the cost of sequencing the human genome has started to decline at a faster rate than Moore's Law. So everyone knows that Moore's Law means that the number of transistors on an integrated circuit is doubling every 12 to 18 months, and the cost of sequencing the human genome has been in most years, declining by a factor of 10, and we are rapidly approaching the $1,000 genome. So these are two examples, but I think one of the really interesting things that we've seen with the internet is the pursuit of grand challenges by in a much more self-organizing and bottom-up way. So Jimmy Wales, the founder of Wikipedia, set the goal of giving freely the sum of the world's knowledge to every single person on the planet in the language of their choice. And that effort has already developed 20 million articles in 282 languages, and they have 365 million readers. So that's an example of something that is not a large centralized effort like the Manhattan Project or the Apollo Project, but something that is more decentralized. So what I'm going to be talking about today is the role that grand challenges are playing in President Obama's innovation strategy, what I believe to be some of the attributes and benefits associated with grand challenges, what are some examples, and what might what President Obama calls an all-hands-on-deck effort that involves not only government, but the private sector and philanthropy and research universities. So the idea of embracing grand challenges is an important part of President Obama's innovation strategy, and he's also specifically highlighted the use of prizes as one of the tools for achieving those grand challenges, which I'm going to be talking about. And for those of you who have not carefully studied President Obama's innovation strategy, there are three parts. The first is the importance of investing in the building blocks of long-term economic growth and job creation, like human capital, like fundamental research, like infrastructure. So one of the reasons that we believe that it's important to invest in fundamental research is that expanding the frontiers of human knowledge is an end in itself, but also it has lots of serendipitous benefits. So one would not think that studying the bioluminescence of jellyfish is something that was going to lead to a lot of economic and societal benefit, but that's how we discovered green fluorescent protein, which has totally revolutionized the way we do biomedical research. So I do believe that it is important to continue to support fundamental research. The second pillar of the president's strategy is to create the right environment for the private sector to innovate and to develop new products and services. So whether it's the Jobs Act that the president just signed that will make it easier for high-growth entrepreneurs to raise capital, or export control reform, or the president's national export initiative to double U.S. exports. The second part really deals with the things that the government can do to create the right overall environment for innovation. And finally, the third pillar, and really the focus of today's talk, is how do we harness innovation to achieve important societal goals, whether it's allowing Americans to lead longer and healthier lives or accelerating the transition to a low-carbon economy that will also reduce our dependence on foreign oil, or transforming the way we do teaching and learning. Some of the grand challenges that U.S. government agencies are already pursuing are the Department of Energy has a series of clean energy grand challenges, including one called Sunshot, where the goal is to make solar as cheap as coal by the end of the decade. Another one called EV Everywhere, where the goal is to make electric vehicles as affordable and as convenient as gas-powered vehicles by 2020. USAID has also been working on some grand challenges on the global development side. And as I mentioned, one of the tools that have been used in the past to achieve grand challenges are prizes. And this is not a new idea. Charles Lindbergh made the first transatlantic flight in response to a $25,000 prize, which was real money back then. And he never would have made it through a traditional peer review mechanism because everyone thought his engine design was crazy. So right up to the day that he was successful, everyone thought he was nuts.
I can just stand by. There's some seats up here for folks in the back. There's three here. There's three or four here. So feel free to come on up and sit down.
Some of the benefits of prizes under the right circumstances when they're well-designed relative to traditional grants and contracts is that you can shine a spotlight on an important problem or opportunity. The sponsor of the prize only has to pay someone if someone is actually successful. You can establish an important goal without specifying in advance which approach or team is most likely to be successful, and you can really dramatically increase the number and diversity of teams that are working on solving a particular problem. Everyone knows what Moore's Law is. How many people know what Joy's Law is? Quiz for the audience. Bill Joy, who's one of the co-founders of Sun Microsystems, used to say that no matter who you are, most of the smart people work for someone else. And prizes are a way of recognizing that. Some other prizes that have been supported recently are the Wendy Schmidt Oil Cleanup X Challenge, which led to a fourfold increase in the ability to do oil spill cleanups, and the NASA Green Flight Challenge, which led to almost a doubling of efficiency of aircraft. As President Kennedy said, one of the goals of having one of the benefits of having these really well-defined goals is that it can make it seem more manageable and less remote, help all people see it, draw hope from it, and to move irresistibly toward it. So when I talk about grand challenges, I don't want to argue that there's a universally accepted definition of grand challenges that everyone has to adopt, but at least the way that OSTP is using the term for purposes of this initiative is that it's something that if it was achieved would have a significant impact in areas of national and global priority. It's ambitious but achievable. If I said that in the next 5 years I want to develop the technology that will lead to the end of scarcity and human immortality, that would certainly be ambitious, but that's not likely to be achieved. And as Arthur Salzberg said, I believe in an open mind, but not so open that your brains fall out. So I think that's something that we should keep in mind as we figure out which grand challenges to pursue. I think it should be compelling and intrinsically motivating. And it has to have a Goldilocks level of specificity and focus, because again, if I said my grand challenge is to improve the human condition, that's a laudable goal, but it doesn't tell me where to start. And then, because we're the Office of Science and Technology Policy, we're obviously focused on grand challenges that are going to harness and require advances in science and technology and innovation. Some of the benefits of grand challenges, obviously, if they're successful, they can help to solve important economic and societal problems. They can serve as a North Star for high-impact collaborations between government, the private sector, and civil society. they can create the foundation for the industries and jobs of the future. So, you know, obviously the reason that the IBM and Qualcomm are pursuing some of these grand challenges is that in addition to the specific target they've identified, they're going to have implications that go well beyond that. I think they can also capture the public imagination. You know, if you ask many people who are in science, technology, engineering related fields who are nearing retirement, a lot of them will say, well, you know, it was Sputnik or it was the space race that really first got me interested as a young kid in this. And I think that these grand challenges, if they're phrased in the right way, if they're really compelling and motivating, can encourage more people to excel in STEM and in entrepreneurship. So those, like, the other point that I wanted to make is that the way, because of the rate at which technology is advancing, I think more and more of the interesting questions are not, you know, what can we do, but what should we do? If we were having this conversation in the 1960s and we were thinking about information technology, the first thing that we would say is, boy, it's really expensive and bulky. You know, if you think about the size of an IBM mainframe at that point. And so just the cost and access to information technology was a real constraint on our ability to solve some of these problems. And although there's, you know, plenty left to do in terms of improving the state of the art, you know, we now have access to huge amounts of computation and the ability to store, process, and transmit information. So again, I think a lot of the interesting questions have shifted from what can we do to what should we do? And those are really normative questions, and questions that are about what goals do we have as a society. So I want to give you a couple of examples. And we'll have on the OSTP website a much longer list, but I'm just going to give you a couple of examples of potential grand challenges. One is that imagine a digital tutor that would allow someone who just has a high school degree to, in a period of, say, 4 to 6 months, get an industry-recognized credential and a job that would increase their salary by 50 to 100%. Why is this important? If you look at the wage data, people who just have a high school degree have been subject to, you know, real declines in their wages. So this is something that we could do that would obviously be a big deal for standards of living for many working Americans. Right now, if you're looking for an organ transplant, there are very long waiting times in order to get that. Work that's going on in regenerative medicine holds out the potential to be able to routinely replace damaged tissues and organs. There are venture-backed firms that are looking at the ability to produce the protein, all the proteins that would be needed by every person on the planet in an area the size of Rhode Island. So as we think about how we're going to feed 9 to 10 billion people on a planet that's going to get hotter and drier, this type of breakthrough in biotechnology could be huge in terms of our ability to do that. Interested in getting more young boys and girls interested in STEM, think about what type of impact it would have to put the tools that are necessary to design and make just about anything at the fingertips of kids, taking advantage of things like 3D printers and makerspaces. Many of our, you know, Rob mentioned a number of defense-related grand challenges. A number of the defense agencies are pursuing ideas that are, you know, straight out of comic books, like, you know, allowing soldiers to walk up walls. So if you had to imagine the next 10 superpowers that the American soldier should have, what would those be? A DARPA grand challenge really led to some significant advances in self-driving cars. So one could imagine self-driving cars that would really dramatically reduce traffic fatalities and free up all that time that we spend on commuting currently. So those are a couple of examples just to get you in the right mood. And as I said, on the OSTP website, we have a longer list that you can take a look at as well. And I want to wrap up by talking about what an all-hands-on-deck effort would look like, because we certainly don't envision this as something that the government would pursue by itself. And I want to talk about the roles that different stakeholders in America's innovation ecosystem could play in both identifying and pursuing grand challenges. So one is that some foundations are beginning to organize their philanthropic activities around grand challenges. So the Gates Foundation, for example, has a series of grand challenges in the global health area. Universities could organize research initiatives around grand challenges. A number of the engineering departments around the country are participating in a program that Chuck Vest at the National Academy of Engineering started called the Grand Challenge Scholars Program that allows undergraduates to organize their coursework, research, experiential learning, international work around the Grand Challenge. We're going to hear from two companies that are involved in these. So obviously companies can play a really important role, whether it's pursuing a Grand Challenge directly or supporting an incentive prize that will accelerate the achievement of a grand challenge. Investors could get involved in supporting startups and other activities that are pursuing a grand challenge. And then finally, I think there is also a really important role for the entertainment industry and for storytellers associated with raising the profile of these. Dean Kamen, the inventor and the founder of the first robotics competition, one of the points that he likes to make is that in a free society, you get what you celebrate. And Tom Friedman observed that one of our problems is that in China, Bill Gates is Britney Spears, and in the United States, Britney Spears is Britney Spears. One of the things that we're hoping is that the entertainment industry and storytellers in our society will lift up these grand challenges, and they'll be a more important part of our national conversation in the same way that the space race was during the 1960s. I think there's also a really important in Washington probably underappreciated role that science fiction plays. There are many instances in which in science fiction, whether it was Arthur C. Clarke talking about communication satellites, or the Star Trek replicator, or the tricorder, or the user interface in the Minority Report, where people saw that and they said, "I want to go out and make that happen." So these become positive, self-fulfilling prophecies. We used to say, "I'll believe it when I see it." And now it's I'll see it when I believe it. Neal Stephenson and some other science fiction writers have started a project called Hieroglyph to depict future worlds in which big stuff gets done. And I think that could have a really interesting impact as well. So, the next slide. Regina Dugan, who was until recently a director of DARPA, gave a great TED talk in which one of the questions she asked was, "What would you attempt to do if you knew you could not fail?" And I think that's one of the, obviously when IBM was, debating about whether to publicly announce this, one of the things that was going on was the question of, okay, if we publicly set this goal, what's our confidence level that you know, we're actually going to be able to achieve it. And I think one of the things that we have to do is to, you know, make it socially acceptable to establish a really big and ambitious goal, even if you're not 100% convinced that we're actually going to be able to achieve that. Because A, sometimes you can. B, sometimes even if you fail, you learn something really interesting from that. So, as I said, later this summer, we're going to be organizing an event at the White House to celebrate and honor those individuals and organizations that are pursuing a grand challenge. And if it's something that you are interested in learning more about, get to know Kristen and send us an email at challenges@ostp.gov. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom. So, Bill, if you want to, sorry. So, everybody, there's seats. There's three seats here. There's three seats here. Bill, Tom, that whole point about learning from science fiction. We were just had a trip out to the Southern California, and one of the companies we visited was Disney, and they actually have designed a holodeck. Mm-hmm. So when they plan their theme parks, they can actually have their designers walk through this mm-hmm. and see things change. I mean, you put this thing on, and then they have you walk over a cliff kind of thing, and like you really don't want to put your foot there, even though you know that it's a floor.
Yep.
And then we also visited another company called Life Technology, where by the end of 2013, they expect to have $1,000 desktop genomic sequencing machine.
Yep.
So you're absolutely right. These visions that we get, that we end up now, we're actually seeing in reality. So, Bill.
Okay, great. Rob, thank you very much for inviting us. And also, thank you for allowing me to follow Thomas, because many of the things that he said, you're going to see again in a slightly different way. So I'm very encouraged how much alignment there is. And I got to jump on a point that Thomas made near the end. When we, and I'll talk about Watson a little bit later, but we had to commit to the Jeopardy show a year in advance. So February 2010, a series of researchers were sitting in the room and were staring at a chart. And the charts talked about the success rate at which Watson was responding to questions. And there's this zone of probability of success and speed that you need to be in to be able to compete with the best who have ever played the game. And we weren't quite there. And so the question is, we got a year, we're not there, do we do this? Because you, as Thomas mentioned, it could be kind of embarrassing if you don't do very well. But there was enough conviction in the room, and the researchers working on it said, we can get there. So my boss, Dr. Kelly, said, we're in. And so we committed to do that game a year before we knew it would actually, we didn't know if it was going to work. We didn't know if we would be really competitive, because we were playing it in-house, and some of the in-house researchers were winning, and that was pretty scary. So there's an example of taking some risks.
And IBM researchers are well known for their knowledge of popular culture.
Exactly. Okay, so let's get started. I just pressed it once. Is that right? Next slide, please. There we go. So what I'm going to do is tell you a little bit of how we think about grand challenges. And what Thomas said and what I'm going to say have a lot of similarities. And we're constantly thinking about grand challenges within IBM. It's a way to motivate us to go do things that are disruptive, to do them in a time frame that others don't imagine. So we kind of break them into three things. One is, are they high risk? Are they game changers from a scientific perspective? And you heard several from Thomas that might fit that bill. Second is, if you could do it, are there implications both on society and ourselves? And I'll talk about some of the ones we've done. So it's not enough to, you know, fly the plane across the ocean. It's, what do I do with it when I've done it? And the last one I think is even more important. What is that powerful proof point? And the way I like to describe it is, when you want to describe to somebody what the grand challenge you're going to do is, can I explain to my 80-year-old mother in a simple example what we're trying to do and have her get it? Can somebody down the street, when I say, we're going to go do this, we're going to go build a machine that's going to beat a grand champion of chess, they can understand the magnitude of that. I'm going to go build a machine that that's going to beat a grand champion at Jeopardy, and here's why. Again, we look for powerful proof points that someone not skilled in the art can understand. And so that's kind of the things that we think about as we look at grand challenges, those three elements. Can you do it? And if you did it, could you extend it? And lastly, can you boil it down to something that you can demonstrate you did it with that others can understand? And that last one turns out to be a real challenge, getting it down to something that anybody can understand what you're doing. So we got a series of other grand challenges we're working on. They're fairly, you know, small in nature in terms of the amount of effort because we're still thinking about where to go next. And so we have a contest within the division. We're looking at what do we really go do next because we realize that, you know, the sponsor thing was a good thing. You know, what's the encore? And so here's a list of a few things we're working on. You saw Thomas's chart about the cost of sequenced DNA, and he was talking about can I get to $1,000? We're trying to do some work with semiconductor technology and computation. Can we get to $100? You know, can we do a sequence in $100? What are the implications if you could do that? Now, if you're an IBM, we're not in the medical space, but think about all the data you would generate if you could go do that, and what kind of business opportunities you could build off of it. Then the last one I want to mention is we made an announcement about a month or two ago at a scientific, in the Boston area, at a symposium about what we're doing in quantum computing. And the joke in the office is we do our reviews of our physical sciences every 6 months. And John always asks, all right, how many qubits have you been able to put together? And we demonstrated a couple months ago we could do 8. And for the first time, the researchers who are working on it, it's a small team, they say, I can envision in my lifetime, my working lifetime, building a quantum computer. You should see the excitement, the fact that they can start to be able to get it to stay together long enough I can actually do something with it. And so you can see us really wanting to accelerate that thought. And that's really, really powerful when you can get that kind of that tipping point where it actually becomes possible. So those are the ways we think about grand challenges. I'm going to talk a little bit about Deep Blue. Back in the early 90s, we thought about how do we build systems that can solve very, very complex problems. And the whole idea of can you build a machine that can play chess has been around for much longer than you might imagine. So some of the first instances of thinking about it were in the 1850s. When people were building tabulating machines, could they build something that could actually play chess? So we brought together a team to say, could we go do this? Could we build a machine that could play chess? You know, if you can build it to play chess, can you build it to play beat the very best that the world has to offer? Now, Thomas, as you mentioned earlier, you have to be willing to fail. You know, if you go do your Google or Wikipedia searches, you find out that IBM actually the first time we tried with Kasparov, we failed miserably. We were pretty quiet about it. The first time was not so good. The second time, which was in 96, we lost the match but won a game. So for the first time, we demonstrated we could actually win a game of chess against a grandmaster. It was when he gave us the chance to do it again in 97 that we actually won the match. Again, it went down to the last game, but we actually won the match. And, you know, in some ways you could argue it's a little bit about timing. And many of these grand challenges we work on, it is a confluence of things that come together that allow you to be successful. But first of all, we weren't as successful when we started. So, you know, we viewed Deep Blue as a very, very major grand challenge for us. And it really did start a whole area of computer science and computing for us that I'll build off in a moment. The next one we chased was late 90s, and what was the motivation? The motivation is, as a supercomputer company, we're behind. And oh, by the way, for those in the room who think about government policy, the U.S. was behind. Because in the late 90s, called 98, 99, the Japanese were at the top of the heap when it came to supercomputers. They had the Riken machine, they had a Earth simulator from NEC, and so the question was, what are we going to do about it? But we had a different problem. When we thought about where we would go next in computing, we knew that Deep Blue wasn't going to scale. If we wanted to build a machine that could really do really, really interesting problems, It would be the size of a football field, and we need the power of a small city. And so the team said, well, can I, you know, can I think of doing computing in a different way? And the thought was, could I make a problem highly parallelized? And could I use microprocessors that might be slower, but use less power? Could I combine them in some way? So I was there when the researchers came in and said, we think we can build a machine that can do problems that are highly parallelized. And we said, okay, what's the challenge? What are we going to go do? What is it that we're going to go do here? And we said, we're going to go out and build a machine that can model protein fold. Because for those in the biosciences realized that all the modeling on how proteins fold was extremely difficult to do and extremely inaccurate because the amount of computations you need to do was tremendous. In the case of Deep Blue, it was doing 200 million calculations per second. We needed to get this thing in the trillions. So we started off to go build a machine and an operating system. We had to take an instruction set and reduce it down so that we could try to highly parallelize a problem. Now, this was the first instance that we actually reached out to our friends in the government because we needed a partner to work with us on, how do you build systems at this level of complexity trying to do very, very massively parallel problems? And we looked to Lawrence Livermore. And Lawrence Livermore is the one who worked with us on Blue Gene. And in September 2004, the machine was number one on the top 500 computers in the world. Again, it was the challenge was, could we build a machine that could fold proteins? And where have we gone with that? We announced last year with Argonne, continuing with our relationship and partnership with the government to go build a machine. 10 petaflop machine. Again, our goal with Blue Gene was to build one petaflop. Turns out we didn't quite get to one petaflop. We're a little bit under that, but so last year we delivered, and it's being run this year as a 10 petaflop machine. And you can imagine some of the problems you might try to solve. So think of the grand challenges we brought forward. We're now beginning to bring systems to the marketplace, to government, to other agencies that can think about these kind of problems. And then this year we'll launch and introduce the 20 petaflop machine called Sequoia, which Lawrence Livermore is going to go use to do some very important work in terms of modeling our nuclear stockpile. So this second grand challenge was very much around a challenge, our competitiveness. We couldn't attack the competitiveness without a partner in this case, and that was the National Labs. Our compelling proof we were trying to do was this protein folding. It didn't quite go as well as we would have liked in terms of getting national attention. But now we're at least able to bring some tools to government, to ourselves, and to other companies that they can go apply. And the third and last grand challenge I'll mention today, which everyone's heard a little bit about, is Watson. Now, Watson, actually, the work on this started, the core of it started many, many years ago, if you ask David Ferrucci 10, 15 years ago. And the whole notion is, could you build a machine that can answer a question? That was the fundamental premise. Could you build a machine that could answer a question, handling natural language, handling unstructured data? And it turned out it was one of the software research leaders in research, IBM Research, who stumbled across Jeopardy and said, hey, this would be that powerful proof point. Could we play the game of Jeopardy? Why did Jeopardy make sense? Remember the chess case. In the case of the chess, it's a bounded game. There are fixed types of moves. The playing field is fixed. So you have some constraints that you can work with. Protein folding, there are not as many constraints. In the game of Jeopardy, it is a fixed question with only one known answer. And we had the compute power and the storage capacity that we could take the corpus of data we needed and put it in resident memory. So that's why Jeopardy made sense. We could compete against the very best that have ever played the game, and it was bounded. And as you saw in February 2011, we actually won against the grand champions, who the very best who've ever played the game. As a little side note, we've played against a few different universities. we've kind of stopped because, you know, the guys at Berkeley and Stanford got pretty close to beating us, so a little worried about doing it. Harvard, MIT, not so bad, but the Berkeley, Stanford guys, they gave us a run for our money. So we've retired, Watson. If you come to our research lab and our solutions lab, you can come and play, Watson, and get a chance to stand at the podiums and play. But again, I told you earlier we made the bet on could we do this in time, but it was building off a whole set of history of natural language, computing. It all came together to go do this. So where are we going to take Watson? And, you know, again, it started as a project. We invested, started in 2006. We went public and demonstrated the world in 2011. Along the way, we had some partnerships that we'd started with Sloan Kettering, with WellPoint, with others, and just recently with Citigroup, on how do you take Watson to the next level. And here's the important part, because I would tell you this grand challenge hasn't ended. You know, we built a machine that can answer questions when you give it a fixed corpus of data, and the question has only one right answer. And even with that, it still makes some mistakes. When it did Final Jeopardy, the question was, the title was U.S. Cities. It was asked the question, name a city that has as its largest airport is named after a World War II hero, and its second airport is named after a major World War II battle. It came back, what is Toronto? So it clearly missed it. So two things come out of it. One was it had to answer because it was Final Jeopardy. Number two, its confidence was very low, about 20%. So normally it would never have responded. But three, there was ambiguity. And when you think about U.S. cities, sometimes in the literature you find out U.S. cities are confused with North America cities. And it turns out the answer to the question is Chicago, O'Hare, and Midway. O'Hare being a famous general, Midway being a famous battle. But so we're not there yet. So where do you go next? And that is, how do I solve problems? And I like to use the following adage. It's not the answer to the question you asked that's important. It's the answer to the question you should have asked. And that is what we're trying to build as we move to the next, you know, where do we take this grand challenge with Watson? How do you build a system that can interact? And that's why we started with our friends at Sloan on the cancer side, with WellPoint in delivering healthcare services, because now you've got three different attributes. The corpus of data is increasing. There may not be a precise answer. And the question you may be asked about a patient's condition may be the wrong one. You just don't know. So we're working with Sloan and working with WellPoint on building a system that will do just that, which is it'll take in some data, unstructured data, you know, maybe it'd be video, you know, it could be MRIs, could be just the writings from a doctor, and it's going to say, given all of its data, you say, what's the disease? It'll come back and says, I think I know what it is, but does the patient have the following other symptoms? And based on that, reevaluate what it might recommend. So you could see how you could extend that kind of capability to other industries. The call centers. How many of you make a phone call to go ask for help on a call, on a helpline, and get frustrated because whoever's on the other side doesn't know what you really want answered? Maybe we can have Watson figure out how to do that. And then last but not least, we think that, you know, in the case of delivering financial services, there's a whole host of things that you would want to iterate with somebody about what is the right question you're trying to answer. So let me close with where I started, which is when we think about grand challenges, it has to have the three characteristics. Is it a game changer? And if we do it and we're successful, can we take it to other domains and other areas and expand on it? And lastly, to get the excitement and the attention of the population at large, can you do something that's compelling? Something that the moment you've done it, they understand it, they can appreciate it and visualize it. You know, I showed you three grand challenges. The first one and the third one were very clear. I'm going to build a machine that can beat at chess. I'm going to build a machine that can win at Jeopardy. I'm going to go build a machine that's going to do protein folding. Doesn't quite match that last piece. So that's what I had to share today. I want to say again, thanks for having. Our partnership with the government and the national labs has been critical. Many of these challenges cannot be done without those kind of partnerships. And I hope this was useful.
Thank you. Also, that other folks, there's two seats up here, there's a seat here, there's several seats over here, so feel free to come on up and have a seat.
Good morning, folks, and thank you, Rob and team, for having me here. I'm Rick Valencia with Qualcomm Life, and I was sharing with my colleagues here when I first got here this morning that I'm actually relatively new to Qualcomm. I've been with the company just under 2 years, and I've spent most of my professional career on my own brand challenges, building businesses and industries, and I have the I'm blessed now that I have the job of helping Qualcomm on one of their next grand challenges, which is helping to bring wireless technology into healthcare, particularly into medical devices. And I was mentioning to my friends here that that I've, in that 2 year period of time, I keep finding myself in places where I look around thinking, what in the hell am I doing here amongst this crowd? I'm not a scientist, I'm not a technologist, I'm an entrepreneur. But as mentioned, I've been on my own grand challenges, and the one that I'm working on right now, Qualcomm Life, was a business that was launched just last year here in Washington, D.C. at the mHealth Summit. And the business is about bringing wireless technology, both the core technology and also the ability to, the core technology into the device, getting wireless technology into a medical device or connected with a medical device, but also managing that device once it's out in the real world. Qualcomm is very good at connecting devices to operator networks and managing the data from those devices. And my role at Qualcomm is to build that business. And it's early stages, but it's very exciting times to see the opportunity that we have in that space to really have an impact on healthcare in the world. Some of you may know of Qualcomm, many of you may not. Corporate Qualcomm is about a $20 billion company that has a number of grand challenges underway at any given time, including right now we have a project underway that is trying to create, through sensor technology, a replica of the human brain. And there's actually a demonstration that you can see now, very, very early stages, but it'll scare you when you do see it, and just how far we've gone in such a short period of time. But I'm here today not representing Qualcomm Life or representing Qualcomm. I'm here representing the Qualcomm Foundation. That's the charitable arm of Qualcomm, and the foundation teamed with the XPRIZE Foundation, and we have launched and announced just at CES a couple months ago the Qualcomm Tricorder XPRIZE. Any Trekkies in the room? So you know what a tricorder is, right? The diagnostic device that you hold above a person, and it diagnoses whatever ails them.
You know what it really was? It's a salt shaker.
A salt shaker. What is that? What you're telling us is that they took a salt shaker off of a table, dressed it up, and made it look like a...
what they said.
I like it. I didn't know that. I'll remember.
Maybe
that.
You should use that.
I'm going to use that next time. My presentation. So the $10 million Qualcomm Tricorder XPRIZE is a global competition to stimulate innovation and integration of precision diagnostic technologies, making reliable health diagnoses available directly to health consumers in their homes. It will integrate diagnostic technology on a consumer mobile device that's easy to use, allowing individuals to incorporate health knowledge and decision-making into their daily lives. The winners will be teams whose technologies most accurately diagnose a set of diseases independent of a healthcare professional or facility, and that provide the best consumer user experience with their devices. So imagine the combination of wireless sensors, imaging, and non-invasive lab replacement, if you will. Think of spitting onto your phone or onto your tricorder and getting a diagnosis. That's the grand prize, or the grand challenge that we've developed along with XPRIZE. So first, a little bit about XPRIZE. Imagine if we could cure disease or eradicate hunger. Those are the types of efforts that are underway at XPRIZE. XPRIZE Foundation is turning these dreams into reality by creating and managing incentivized prize competitions to bring about radical breakthroughs for the benefit of humanity in the following areas: life sciences, global development, energy and environment, and education and exploration. Their goal is to accelerate the pace of innovation through these challenges. So why healthcare? Well, we're getting fat, we're getting old, and we're getting sick. That's really what it comes down to.
And not taking our pills.
And we're not taking our pills the way we should, and that costs a lot of money as well. Globally, there's 400 million people with obesity, 860 million people with a chronic disease. In the U.S. and Europe, over 60% of people have two or more chronic diseases, and up to 90% of all health spending goes towards treating just that chronic disease. In the developed world, preventable medical errors result in tens of thousands of deaths per year. In the developing world, people don't get diagnosed. And so clearly, healthcare in general, any change in healthcare is a grand challenge. In fact, my most recent example was just last week. I went in for some lab tests in advance of a physical, an annual physical, and I've got the results back, and they're all pretty good. I had a couple of questions. I didn't want to bother my doctor. It's hard to call and get a hold of your doctor. So I called the nurse, and I said, can I get his email address? And the answer was, no, the doctor doesn't give out his email address. So my grand challenge right now is to get my doctor's email address. And at the same time, I'm trying to change the world of healthcare. So why specifically diagnostics? Well, the impact of infectious disease epidemics just from 1995 to 2008, many of them preventable, exceeded $120 billion globally. More than 90% of deaths from infectious diseases are caused by a handful of diseases that are largely preventable and treatable. But again, as mentioned, lots of misdiagnosis, and in the emerging markets, they don't have the benefit of getting in front of a doctor in a lot of cases to get a diagnosis at all. So, the prize itself, and I'm going to ask for a little bit of help if you can on that video. If you can turn that on, I'm going to show you a real quick video here from CES where we announced the XPRIZE. And I'll tell you as we're trying to get that running that, there we go. Sort of. It's off centered if you can. There you go. Can we hear it or no? Do you have audio? So, Paul happens to be a Trekkie, and he was actually sitting on a panel a couple years back.
Here at CES, there's really no better audience to understand the future of technology and its ability to reach and improve all areas of our lives. To realize this future, the Qualcomm Foundation is going where no one has gone before by pioneering new health technologies. So our goal is nothing less than to revolutionize healthcare around the globe. And to do this, we're partnering with the XPRIZE Foundation, an organization that conducts mega competitions to incentivize breakthroughs like the ones needed to improve healthcare for all of us.
We're extraordinarily proud to be partnering with such an extraordinary company to announce a transformative competition, the Qualcomm Tricorder XPRIZE. It's $10 million of purse money. It's open to teams anywhere on the planet. And our goal, as Paul said, is to revolutionize healthcare, to provide it literally in the palm of your hand. The winning team has to be able to do the following: allow the individual to diagnose themselves without using a doctor or going to a physician, and it has to be easy and fun to use. We are gonna drive an era of healthcare abundance so that anyone on the planet with access to a mobile device will be able to have healthcare in the palm of their hand.
So Paul Jacobs is a Trekkie himself, and he was sitting on a panel, and they were talking about healthcare, and the topic came up of wireless devices helping in diagnosing disease. And And Paul mentioned that it'd be cool if we had a tricorder, if we really had a tricorder. Well, somehow Peter Diamandis got word of that and got a hold of Paul within a couple of months and was in our offices in San Diego. And a year and a half or so later, we made this announcement. And it's something that Paul Jacobs and Qualcomm is very proud to be a part of. You're going to be hearing, by the way, in May, about a month from now, an announcement in support of this that I can't share with you right now. I'd love to, but the news will be made in the middle of May that is going to be connected to this, and it's going to, in essence, it's going to be, this is a four-year program, by the way, and it's going to be a program very closely aligned to this program that's going to be unfolding during that four-year period of time. So that's all I can tell you right now, but you'll hear details about that in May. The in case you didn't hear what they were saying on stage there, let me tell you a little bit more specifically about what the Tricorder X Prize is all about. So it's funded solely by Qualcomm. It's a $20 million grant from Qualcomm Foundation. $10 million goes to support the operation. $10 million goes towards the actual prizes. The teams can develop are assigned the objective of developing precision diagnostic technologies that are available to consumers on their mobile devices in a way that is engaging, desirable, and willingly adopted. So this is going to be judged by a group of that forward for me? It's not moving. This will be, the winners will be judged by a group of judges. It'll be narrowed down over a period of time to a handful of 25 to 50 teams, and then they will announce the final award winner in June of 2015. To date, if we go one more slide. Oh, here we go. We have over 160 teams that are pre-registered, because registration doesn't even start until October of this year. We have 160 teams pre-registered in 22 countries and 22 states in the U.S. Most of the teams are from the U.S., but they're from all over the world. And one of the challenges that I have for you is that we likely don't have the winner signed up yet. And so we'd love for you to be thinking about yourself or people you know that might want to join the fight and register and become one of the teams trying to help solve this grand challenge. What we're expecting to happen over the next few years is a number of these teams who register for the Tricorder X Prize to work together and eventually come together we end up with fewer teams competing, but because it's combining a lot of the ideas and the entrepreneurial spirit of some of these registrants into combined teams. What we're really trying to do here is we're really trying to put more control of healthcare in the hands of the consumer. And we're moving from an environment where we're basically managing sick people to managing people, helping them stay healthy, moving them out of high acuity environments in hospitals and letting them manage their care in home. And as you can imagine, something like the Tricorder can go a long ways in helping us achieve that goal. Excuse me?
A few more minutes.
Well, guess what? I don't even need one more minute on it.
All right,
pretty much wrap that. So that's my presentation. And if you've got any questions, I've got a little bit more detail on the exact prize and how you go about registering. But thank you very much for allowing me to join you this morning.
Thank you.
Well, that was great. And one of the things I love about these presentations is just how how optimistic we should all be about the future, because I'm confident that all of these challenges are going to get solved at some point, and life's going to be a lot better because of it. if not for me, then at least for my son and our kids. So we have plenty of time for questions or comments. If you want to raise your hand and identify yourself and who it's to. Yes, sir.
Sure. Bill Koglitz from the State Department. A question for Tom. Some of the grand challenges are open competition, others are not. And of course, there are open competitions that are not grand challenges, but still very useful and important. I'd be interested in sort of your view of how much an overlap you see here and what work OSTP is doing also on open competition.
Sure, yeah, that's a good question. And by a grand challenge, we just mean an ambitious goal that is going to require science, technology, and innovation to achieve. So, for example, the way that IBM pursued the grand challenge associated with beating the Jeopardy champion was not to do a prize. It was to get 20-odd really smart people at IBM working on the problem. So a prize or a challenge is just one mechanism to achieve a grand challenge. And obviously, there are lots of use of prizes that are a lot more modest than the, you know, $10 million tricorder prize. A number of agencies, for example, have are really dramatically increasing the amount of data that they are making available to the public. And then they will have very low dollar open challenges associated with encouraging third-party developers to take that data and develop apps that will be useful to the public. And that's a worthwhile activity, but that doesn't really, you know, rise to the level of a grand challenge.
By the way, if I can add, financial incentives do work. Financial incentives work really well. And when Peter Diamandis first spoke to him about this, he said to me, we're not trying to make prize winners here. We're trying to help create an industry. And what the goal is, of course, is much grander than giving out a bunch of money. But giving out money helps. And we've got a number of companies that have registered for the competition that have actually been able to go out and raise venture capital to help build a business that is competing for the challenge.
Yes, sir. I'm John Kalil, retired Air Force flyer. I teach for the Army now, command general staff. That's a long story how that happened. I'm reminded of good old Adolf Galland. He was defender of Germany. If you try to defend everything, you defend nothing. Here I hear, if you try to invent everything, we invent nothing. What is wrong with the administration setting some lofty goal, like the good old trip to Mars, like Kennedy went to the moon? What's wrong with the trip to Mars? Why wouldn't that work?
Well, you know, the administration's space policy contemplates eventually going to Mars, but not as the next thing that we do in space. You know, I think one of the things is that we believe is that the technology that we have today would not allow us to get to Mars in an affordable way, so that we would have to do some significant technology development to reduce the cost, reduce the time, and increase the human safety associated with going to Mars. So we don't believe that that is the next goal that we can accomplish through space policy.
Yes, sir. Here.
Robert Weibel, Robert Weibel Associates and Theotech. Is there any aspect of the grand challenge looking at the barriers to the application of technology, be they regulatory or social? Is that in the grand challenge mix?
Absolutely. I think, for example, one of the things that happened as a result of the Ansari X Prize is that there was a lot of collaboration between the X Prize Foundation and the FAA to figure out what were the legal and regulatory barriers associated with commercial space and how could they be addressed. So although the emphasis a lot of times is on the technology, these are embedded in, you know, broader economic, societal, legal factors. And I think one of the additional values of Grand Challenge is it causes you to focus on, from a systems perspective, what's everything that you need to do to solve the problem. So when the Department of Energy launched the SunShot program, one of the things that they discovered is that even if you made the module available for free, you still wouldn't achieve the goal. because of the cost associated with permitting, balance of systems, installation, and Sunshot is addressing those as well, in addition to, you know, developing new material systems for photovoltaic modules.
Yeah, just in that context, we did an event recently with Fiatech on construction innovation, and the Europeans do have a challenge around construction innovation. How do they transform their industry to be more innovative, through partly through IT? But as Tom said, you can't get there just with that. You got to restructure zoning and planning and a whole set of other things. I'll go to the back over here, and then Sean, and then
James Sang, IBM Research, retired. Question for Tom on the bound. This is a follow up on the last one on the boundaries of grand challenges. Well, I can think of problems, for example, like Mervyn Kelly at Bell Labs when he turned Shockley, Vardeen, and Bratton loose on creating a solid-state switch as being a nice grand challenge problem. But one can think of the long roads through Kirby and Noyce and all the stuff that gave us the IC as not obviously being a grand challenge problem, because there's a lot of bits and pieces. It took many years to go through.
Yep.
Do we have a good feel for what is... the boundaries are of good grand challenge problems, are other than if it works, it is, and if it isn't, it wasn't.
I think that there is a certain amount of judgment that is associated with this. I don't know that we have a science. I mean, as you heard from your IBM colleague, you know, that there's also this element of capturing the public imagination that I think is associated with a good grand challenge. So I think that there are technical challenges that are really important, like efficient programming of many core processors that I think are incredibly important for the progress of the industry. But if you said, would I nominate that to be a grand challenge, that doesn't pass the 80-year-old mother test of explaining why efficient programming of many core is something that is going to transform her life, unless that is associated with using that underlying technology to solve a particular problem.
Yeah, I completely agree. It's back to the other point in the back of the room. The other problem with grand challenges is it has to be the right time with the right building blocks underneath it. So about which ones you go after, it has to be the right time with the right things. And that's what we need to be thinking about.
Sean Poole, the Science Progress at the Center for American Progress. I have a question for Tom, just on the kind of policy question. It sounds like the way you introduced this concept, grand challenge is a very decentralized concept. You've got Sunshot and DOE and different challenges, and it's sort of, you know, IBM, Qualcomm doing their own challenges separate from government. I'm wondering what work, if any, you guys are doing to institutionalize this in policy in federal structure permanently versus what it seems like you're doing, which is kind of generally promoting the concept of it and trying to capture public imagination.
So a couple things on the institutionalization side. One is to give the agencies the tools that they need in order to be able to do this. So for example, we worked with Senator Pryor and other senators to introduce legislation as part of the America Competes bill that gives all agencies the ability to support prizes and challenges of up to $50 million. So that's an example of creating a new tool that is at the disposal of agencies that allows them to pursue some of these things. And although in my remarks I said, well, you know, government can do this, private sector can do this, research universities can do this, we definitely have in mind multi-sector collaborations in order to achieve these grand challenges, because as you heard on the Blue Gene example, that in order to achieve that, that required a collaboration between IBM, the Department of Energy, and Lawrence Livermore in order to be able to achieve. And I suspect that many of the grand challenges will fall into that category where they're large enough so that no one institution is in a position to achieve them.
Lynn?
Yeah, Lynn Etheridge, Rapid Learning Health System Project at George Washington University. I was intrigued by the fact that so many of your examples and challenges are in healthcare. But it leads me to the question that about what we need to change institutionally that might make more progress. Several of you mentioned DARPA is obviously has a key role in the defense area and starting many things. We have National Energy Labs. But at the same time, for the successes in healthcare, like the Human Genome Project, we've had spectacular 40-year failures like the war on cancer. Do we need to change institutionally what we do in health? Do we need a DARPA agency for healthcare? Do we need a National Energy Labs kind of structure?
Well, we are looking at new institutions. So one example that our NIH director, Francis Collins, has been pursuing is called the National Center for Advancing Translational Science, which is precisely trying to accelerate the movement of ideas from the bench to the bedside. And so that's, and NIH and DARPA are also starting to collaborate. So they there's a project that President Obama announced that involves NIH and DARPA each doing what they do best to develop new technologies that will transform the way we do preclinical toxicology and trying to figure out the safety and efficacy of new drugs. One of the problems that we have is that we have a lot of failures at phase two and phase three when the private sector has already invested hundreds of millions of dollars in clinical trials. And if we had the ability in a way that is much more predictive than mouse models of safety and efficacy, that would be a game changer. The reason that NIH is doing this is that they also want to learn how DARPA does program management, which is very different from the traditional
Absolutely.
NIH
So, Tom, I'm going to take the liberty of asking a question of you and also at the same time having a commercial for our event next week. So on the chair, you should see this. So we're doing an event on Thursday of next week called the Innovation Consensus. We've got Senator Mark Warner, Senator Coons, Senator Moran, a number of other leaders, Becky Blank, Undersecretary of Commerce. And the idea of that event is that really, you know, we've become so partisan and the bitterness around policy issues, you know, whether it's abortion or guns or all these other things. But this is an area we shouldn't have any partisanship. We should have minimal partisanship. And how do you sort of see this playing out, this new initiative, this new vision? Do you see it as an area where you think there's going to be at least some partisan support on both sides of the aisle around these kinds of things?
That's certainly my hope. And I do believe that innovation policy has been an area that has been less partisan. A good example of that is that President Obama, in the Jobs Act speech that he gave last fall, said, hey, let's reduce the regulatory barriers to high-growth entrepreneurs being able to raise capital. He then followed that up with a Startup America legislative agenda in which he identified a series of proposals that he would support. And he said, you know, if you pass this, I will sign it. And that's exactly what happened. The president, when he signed the legislation, was joined by Eric Cantor and high-growth entrepreneurs and venture capitalists. This is going to allow crowdfunding, micro-equity investments of up to $1 million. It's going to increase the size of so-called mini public offerings that are allowed from $5 million to $50 million. It is creating an IPO on-ramp so that firms have more time to comply with things like Sarbanes-Oxley. And we're optimistic that it will make it easier for high-growth entrepreneurs to raise capital while maintaining some of the essential investor protection. And that had overwhelming support on both sides of the aisle and on both the House in both the House and the Senate.
Great. Yes, sir, and then here.
Paul O'Day with the Synthetic Fiber Association. Recently, the president announced a $1 billion program to create a manufacturing innovation network. And I'm wondering, Tom, if there's any connection between that grant plan and grant challenges, and for the other two panelists, whether there should be.
Yeah, so I'll say a little word about this. This is a proposal that is in the president's FY13 budget. And the idea is to invest in a network of manufacturing innovation institutes that would be focused on some specific advanced manufacturing problem or opportunity, and that would create collaborations between government, industry, and academia, and that would also help bridge the valley of death between basic research on the one hand and product and process development being done in the private sector. That is in the president's FY13 budget. In FY12, we're doing a pilot focused in the area of additive manufacturing, or as it's sometimes known, 3D printing. So imagine being able to see a design of a product, hit the button, and actually see it materialize before you.
Great. So I wanted to ask a question of our two private sector folks, and maybe Tom, you can jump in on this. You know, Bill, you alluded to the fact, or mentioned the fact, that you've worked with the national labs. And I wonder how, anyone on the panel, maybe Bill, you could start us off. How do you see the role of the national labs playing in the system? I mean, the role of the labs is kind of in flux right now. It's not clear exactly sometimes what their mission is. And how do you see that? Maybe, Tom, how do you also see that playing out? Are we looking at structural or operational changes that are needed?
Our experience with the national labs has been very, very good. The key is they've been able to bring problems to us that, and data sets and expertise that we just don't have. You know, we can build computers, we can build all kinds of things, but getting something that will work in a real life environment. So I think the national labs need the ability to bring more of those kind of problems in, leverage their expertise, and leverage folks like IBM on those kind of problems. Because the one thing the national labs have that I think some people forget is they got this deep knowledge of science and technology built over many, many decades that we just got to tap into more often and be more open to bringing ideas and problems from outside their norm or purview to go do this. And we've seen, like with Sandia and others in Los Alamos, they have moved, but they can move a lot more. And I think that would be extremely powerful for commercial entities and for the country at large.
Yes, sir.
I'm Paul Runcie. I'm from the Pacific Northwest National Lab, and that was the perfect segue for the question I wanted to ask. Which is, first of all, I appreciate you're saying that the labs have such a critical role to play in these grand challenges. But what concerns me is the sort of asymmetry in the funding models in between the private sector and the labs. And you know, the labs right now are in a very uncertain environment, and it's very hard to sustain these sort of grand challenges in the infrastructure that's necessary for them in an uncertain environment. So I wanted to kind of open it up, throw it to the panel, if you had any thoughts on, you know, alternative funding models or, you know, partnerships that can somehow bridge this uncertainty.
What we think is that the national labs can be a center for other institutions, including a lot of private ones, to go do work. Think about the recent initiatives on big data that have come from the government. You know, think about centers to go tackle big data problems where they could be housed at some of the national labs, and other government and commercial entities could come and tap into the capabilities that could be housed there. I can see that being extremely powerful because it's called a neutral site. You know, if I was at Lawrence Livermore, Pacific Northwest, and I'm going to go use a compute platform there, working on algorithms to solve problems on very, very large data sets, it's kind of a neutral ground. You can do work, and people can feel a little bit easier doing things collaboratively than you might say if Qualcomm and I wanted to go and IBM wanted to work on a certain project. So I can envision that you would want to build those kind of, partnerships. And that would help defray the costs. And also, it would force some longevity, because no institution, commercial institution, is going to sign up to go work with one of the government labs if they got to worry that next year that compute platform is going to disappear because of funding restrictions. You'd have to kind of hardwire that. And, administration would have to kind of look at how you might do that.
Okay. Last question.
So there's been a lot of, Justin Hicks, University of California, Merced, soon to be joining ITIF. I have a quick question. So there's been a lot of talk about collaboration, but prizes are inherently an individual incentive. So I'm interested as to how you actually think of incentivizing collaborative activity, because the prize model really doesn't speak to that, especially a lot of the concerns that have been brought up.
Two points. One is that, again, a prize model is only one of many ways to pursue a grand challenge. That's the first point I make. Second point is that you can design a prize competition in a way that encourages collaboration. So, for example, if you look at the Netflix competition, that really was designed in a way that encouraged teams to share information about how they were making progress, so that the solutions wound up being kind of a best of breed of a number of different approaches. So it is possible. And from a sociological point of view, you find that even people who are competitors will form a community of interest and help each other out, you know, even if their goal is to be the team that wins. So even in an area where you do have, you know, intense collaboration and people want to win, you still see people helping each other out empirically.
Rick, do you want to just spend a minute on that? Because it sounds like that's one of the goals.
Yeah, completely agreed. That's not only a goal, we're already seeing it happen. We're seeing some of these teams come together. It's a difficult problem that we're trying to solve. And so to think that a team is going to be able to achieve that on their own is hard for me to believe. So yes, a goal of the program is to foster collaboration of these teams so that ultimately we'll be working with 4 or 5 or 10 teams combined into one as the ultimate winners.
Well, that's great. So I think we will plan to do this event in 2015 and demonstrate the salt shaker.
Yes, take it back with the salt shaker.
And we'll also demonstrate some amazing Watson, Super Watson. That's maybe what we'll be talking about.
Watson 2.0.
So please join me in thanking a great panel.